Bumps and bruises, scratches and scrapes, some of the ingredients that a good life makes. But sorrows become success, and as we aim for the top, we will pause if we must, but we will never stop. Welcome to Simso Sessions. Hello there and welcome to Simso Sessions, the safe space to share your stories. Tonight, we're talking to someone who's seen as one of Jamaica's most controversial artists, but she's really such a sweetheart. Tanya Stephens is my guest first though. We're linking with one of our guests from season 5 for our check-in today. It is Chenille Simpson, Warrior Muma, joins us via Zoom. Hi, Shan, how are you?
I'm good.
Oh, it's so good to see you, Mama. Catch us up. First off, thank you for being on the show. How is your princess, Nyla?
My little fighter. She's doing good. She's been amazing so far. You know, we've been home, you know, just trying to make sure that she's well. So for the past few months, and you know, since then, she's been just fighting and keeping strong, keeping energetic, you know, very vibrant as always. So she's been amazing so far.
And how is her mom?
Her mom. I'm doing good. I've honestly been on a very good journey. I've been blessed. We have been celebrating after the show. I got married after the show. And
yay!
I am now expecting.
What?
So I'm 8 months pregnant. I know I'm about to have baby anytime now, whenever he decides to come.
Oh my gosh. Congratulations,
yes.
Lady.
Thank you.
So great. Oh my gosh. How was it after the show? Tell me what the response was. You got such an outpouring of love from so many people.
Yeah. A lot of people reached out to me. A lot of people reached out via Instagram. Some people recognized me on the streets, mostly Nyla, when we go supermarket shopping or any errands that we're running. So it's been interesting, and I'm really thankful for those that reached out to me and gave me, you know, really kind words, you know, prayed for us, blessed us in whatever way that's possible. So it has been really good. You know, we now have extended family because of that. A lot of people still check in with Nyla. You know, they will call, they will send messages, they will email us just to see how she's doing. And I mean, she takes all those calls, so she handles them.
She handles them?
Yeah, she handles them.
Oh, wow.
She handles them. So everyone is her auntie or her cousins or whomever it is that she connects with.
Yeah.
So that's good.
Are things a little easier for you now, Chenille, because you were having a tough time when you were last here? Work was spotty.
Yeah.
Bills were racking up and, you know, there was a lot going on.
Yes. Yes. It has improved a lot, thankfully. I mean, not just with my village and my community supporting us, but just, you know, finding a source of income, you know, trying to make sure that family's okay. Now that I'm married, my partner as well, he has been a major help and support with just helping us to get by. Mm-hmm. And not just financially, but mentally, mm-hmm. you know, that support that was necessary, mentally, emotionally, you know. So we have been in a better place, thankfully. We're not 100% out of the woods as yet with Nyla, where she's concerned. But we pray every day and we make sure that we do our best on our side to ensure that she's good.
Sure. You were looking into, one of the things we were talking about was looking into care for her overseas. Any update on that?
Yes. No updates on that as yet. We're still working towards that. We've been in communication with two hospitals, one in more Minnesota side, and then another one is in Florida. Mm-hmm. So we are just basically keeping in touch with them. What we tend to do is just do checks on her just to make sure that she's okay. Do some scans, make sure that there's nothing that's traveling, make sure there's nothing spreading, etc. And then we will know more, like, in the new year, you know, okay. Once we have this baby and we're all settled again, then we can know where we're going in the new year.
Fantastic. We are so happy for you. We wish you nothing but the best in this new stage of your life. We wish Nyla health and strength in your new marriage. We wish for you a happiness. And with your new baby, we wish for you a happy landing, Shans. You deserve all the happiness in the world.
Okay. Thank you so much.
And please give her our love, please.
I will.
Awesome. Thank you so much. All right, folks, that's Chenille, warrior mama Simpson. Boy, me love good news. Happy? So nice. Nice when good things happen to good people. All right, when we come back, it's time for Tanya. You don't want to miss that. Stay with us. We're back with more on SimSoul. Welcome back to the show, everybody. So I've known this lady for a long time. She's one of our most prolific songwriters and accomplished artists. A long history of outspokenness has made her the subject of many a controversial debate. But Tanya Stephens, she don't care. She's regarded by many as a voice for those who aren't able to speak for themselves. Her life has been an interesting tapestry of experiences, and she shares some of those with us tonight. Welcome, my friend. It's good to have you.
Thank you very much for having me.
Do you know that you're the first guest on this set who has stayed in their dark glasses?
So maybe that's one of the things we can talk about.
Yes.
One of my dysfunctions, I hide behind the glasses. So you can't get rid of one dysfunction in one session.
No, this is true. But why you call it a dysfunction though?
Because having the need to hide behind a pair of glasses definitely has to be a dysfunction.
You're very honest with yourself.
I am. I'm a driver.
And tell me why you feel the need to hide behind. This is taking us down a different road, but I have to explore it. Why you find the need to hide behind? I don't think
well, ever since entering, it is not a fear of people, but it is compensation for a lack of complete privacy. Because when you enter public life, you have to know this. You don't get space. And if the eyes are the windows to the soul, it stands to reason that every time you step out, the truth is I don't get to hide anything. And sometimes you just want a little space and privacy. I don't want to wear my emotions on my sleeve. I need to start wearing long sleeves all the time now too, because my arms show what I'm thinking. My eyes and my arms show. I get goosebumps.
Your arms show.
Yeah. Every time I have one emotional reaction to something, I get some big old goosebumps. So I'm going to have to learn to deal with the heat because my foot keep on blazing.
Is that true? Oh my gosh.
It is very annoying.
That's incredible.
I mean, I am very
telling. Yes. Well, this I know. Okay. So I'm learning something new about you today. Okay. So let's go back. I want to talk about Tanya the talker. So you describe yourself, you're born talking, and you've been talking ever since. And adding your voice to so many issues which you deem so important. What is it about Tanya Stephens that makes you just want to weigh in on these issues? You don't care what people think. You don't care how people feel.
Well, first off, let me establish that I only weigh in on issues which are of public interest. I don't care about people's private business at all. I don't have no opinions on those. And I cannot be drawn out on anything private. But when I was younger, a child, I didn't have anybody to speak for me. And there are many issues that faced me, that I faced, many experiences that I had that I wish somebody would say something. And even when I tried to talk to people, nobody even wanted to hear about them. So I listen and I speak.
Mm-hmm. I asked you about your upbringing and how you were raised, and you said, breeze, blow me up. Some people ask you, you said, breeze. Breeze blow me up. What does that mean, T?
you know, like you say, I saw and so grew him. I couldn't point to any particular style of raising a child that actually brought me up. And there are many times there was an absence of authority figure. Mm-hmm. People weren't always there. And you know, Jamaican people have this thing, like, it's like you're not supposed to speak any evil of parents, and especially not mothers. And I come from a single parent home. I was raised by a mother alone. And people see your criticisms as like an indictment on your mother, but for me, it's not criticism either. It's just observation. I didn't really have any structure. I didn't have nobody checked my homework. Nobody checked to make sure. The only thing they check is the report card, and then you get beaten or you get praised. Mm-hmm. But nobody checked to see that along the way you were actually doing what you were supposed to do. So my figure said, breeze blow me up. Come just out there in the elements, man, like tumbleweed. It never got too bad for tumbleweed.
No, not at all. Yeah. You were the sixth of seven. And you say it's a past you're not ashamed of. You're proud to talk about it because it shows that you can overcome.
Of course.
And you say even going into school, you never realized the extent of your poverty until you were in high school.
Yes. High school is brutal. Primary school is a good system for poor people because, well, I don't know how it is now, but when I was going to primary school, we all ate lunch together in the canteen. We all eat the same thing. It was provided. We never buy lunch. We ate lunch at canteen. It was dumpling and whatever meat them cook, our kalaloo. It was rice or bulgur rice. I used to swap my bulgur rice for dumpling.
Okay.
And we were all equal. So whether your parents were well-to-do or you were just comfortable, or you were dirt poor, it didn't really matter when we got together for lunch. But high school, you will notice who's going to the canteen, who's buying chicken and rolls, who is not going to the canteen. I was not going to the canteen.
Who's buying patty and cocoa bread?
Patty and cocoa bread.
We laughed about this and said the notion mm-hmm. that a patty and cocoa bread can define which strata you're from, right? You shouldn't.
And we take these things for granted. People who have things don't see the things that they have. This is what privilege does. So a black man can see white privilege, but a black man can see male privilege. Because he's a man. It's his, that is his positive. He can't see it.
Mm-hmm.
We don't see the things that we have that others don't have. It's a defect that humans have that I don't like. And so many of my friends didn't even know that I was that poor, because me have an argument with one friend when I leave school. A while after, when I was a singer and stuff, me and my high school friends are still close. And I was talking about it on social media and not having lunch and bigging up my friend who I used to hang out with. And another friend who I used to be close with said, but you used to eat lunch, Stephenson. And they used to call me Stephenson, broke up the step behind the son. And I was like, no, I didn't. But we used to all eat lunch together. I'm like, no, we didn't. And she kept insisting, and then she said, oh, well, I guess now that you're in entertainment, you need a story. And man,
what?
Me vex. Me vex. Me tell Simone, me vex with
why would you make up a story about her?
Like me, I tell lie for myself.
How many times you were hungry? You said you got into haggling early.
Oh, gosh,
you and the lady at the gate had an understanding.
The lady at the gate, when I'm girl. Our kids are still around.
The lady's them name
know
was
me.
Girl.
Yes, me used to go look for her when I leave school. I go back and go look for her for a while, and then she died, and it was painful because she died while I was on the road. I didn't get to go to our funeral or anything. Mm-hmm. But girl used to accommodate me with my haggling, because I didn't, like if me have 1 5 cent or 1 10 cent, I'd go out there and expect to get like $1 worth of fruit. And me and her had a haggle over it. And she, I think she really understood me. And she made it seem as if I was bargaining, like I was actually mm-hmm. bargaining. But me grew up and realized it. She gave me fruits.
Wow. People looking out for you.
Yeah.
All right, when we come back, we talk a little more with Tanya on the other side. We'll be right back. All right, so we're back with Tanya. I love the fact that we get to talk to her on the show. School, education was a non-negotiable in your house. Poverty was a thing, but education was at the grades had to be up there.
I forgot school.
But you said when things were rough at home, it reflected in your schoolwork.
Immediately.
And you were chastised for it. And one of the things that bothers you, even to this day, you think with the educational system, is that nobody took the time to find out what was going on with you. Nobody took the time to ask why. You were just chastised.
Yeah, by school and home. So the thing is, if you have a student who is a straight A student or an A and B student, and then suddenly, bam, D, E, F, why would you not sit with the student and see what's going on? Something has to be going on. Nobody goes from A to F. Nobody.
With no underlying reason.
You don't just go there. It has to be some kind of a distraction. And most likely it is something really earth-shattering in that child's life. Because you'd still at least maintain a B or a C. And that's the thing. Nobody checked during school, during the entire term, to see what was going on. But when the report comes back, then you get the beating. Then you get the threats. And then you get the fallout, the fruit of having our kind of colonial system or our kind of class system school, where them have one set of school, which was secondary, which was supposed to be for the bad performing kids. And right away, you punish a picnic for 5 years of their life. For what? For being poor, for never have parents who get them this books so they need for learn, or for never have electricity so them could have studied on them. Go. And then I was threatened that if my grades never pick up back, I'm going to seki. That is the kind of...
secondary school, seki.
Yeah,
seki. Mm-hmm.
For those who don't know secondary school.
Writing was something that you were doing ever since you can remember. But that was a function of all the reading and stuff you were doing. Right?
Yes.
And you loved it. Was it an escape for you?
Definitely an escape. And the good thing about my life is that I had my elder sibling, my biggest sister, who could have been my mother. She's old enough to be my mother. So she left home early because she went out to work and she went to teacher's college. She made sure I could I was reading too early. At 2 years old, I could spell my full name.
Wow.
Vivienne Tanya Stephenson. Full name at two. As soon as I learned to talk, I was spelling. And it feels like it was too early, but the truth is that I ended up making a living off reading and writing.
Yes, believe it.
So books were the most common amenity. We didn't have, most of the time when I was a kid, we didn't have electricity. Never have no TV. One point we have a TV for a little while, one little teeny black and white box. You know, back in the day when JBC signed off. Dian were come on midday and sign off back. Sometimes we would go to our neighbor's house to watch TV through the window. But for the most part, we had none of that.
Mm-hmm.
And books were the entertainment.
Mm-hmm.
That's
mm-hmm.
it. All encyclopedia may read.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, that makes so much sense now. Come when you hear lyrics, trust me. So music was something that you decided you wanted to do towards end of high school. You actually tried to get voiced at a studio in Ultra, so you were turned away. And then you came to Kingston City where you were able to get the studio experience. You came with your sister, you were babysitting your niece at the time, and you got a chance to voice. And that would be a good thing, but that would also be a bad thing.
Yeah, I mean, any industry you're going to find good and bad things. And my bad thing in music, when I came to Kingston first to live, I just finished high school and I was at home. I didn't really know what I was going to do. I started to repeat fifth form to resit. I think it was maths and bio. I don't know why I was trying to resit bio because I don't have nothing to do with the subject.
I was just going
to
say.
Like... I was just going to resit it because I failed it.
Okay.
But somewhere along the way, I stopped. But before I finished the first term, I stopped and I was just at home. And I was like, this is a waste of money. We don't have any. Even the small amount that it takes for paying my bus fare in the morning for go to school, even if I walk back home, it's still a waste of money in bus fare because I'm not learning anything here. So I stopped and then one of my older siblings asked my mother, why not have me come and stay with her and babysit her daughter since I wasn't doing anything. And I went to stay with her. While I was there, one of her in-laws came over and asked what I was doing. And the conversation was very amusing to me because it sounded, she was so embarrassed because they were asking, so she's not going to school, or she's not working either. So you're not going to make her do anything? And I was just there babysitting. So then the next day, she came and asked me, what would I like to do? And I said, well, I sew my own clothes. So she sent me to do fashion designing at a place in Halfway named Robian School of Fashion, upstairs where her mother's is. I did that for a few weeks. And in the process of doing that, well, I'd always been writing. And I write poems. I used to write short stories. And my poems start turning into songs. So in the process of doing that, I was in Halfway Tree sitting down. Like, let me see now. I left school. On the days I had school, I would leave at about 11. And my niece's school, Webster Memorial, was over at 1. So from 11, I walked up to Webster, sat down and waited until 1. And that was really dreary. So I started looking around for studios to go to. And I found New Name Music at the top of Maxfield. And I went there. Hello, I'd like to sing. Big up Miss Dawn Henry. That was the first person over there I ran into. And she was very accommodating. She was nice. Dawn Henry, big up yourself. I really love you. She was nice. She was like, oh, yes, we do accept young artists, unknown people here. You can come in and Noel Brownie and Derek Barnett. They checked me out to see if I had any potential, and they said I did, and that's my first.
So good people who welcomed you, but also some not so good people.
Cloaked
in, what do you call it, wolf in sheep's clothing, be mentors.
Yes.
That's when you experienced your first incident of sexual assault somebody who claimed to be a
mentor. So there was this one artist there at the time who became Big Brother, and when I turned 17, because when I left high school, I turned 16 in the summer. I was in Kingston from the end of the year. And then when I turned 17 on the 2nd of July the following year, my sister realized that I was 17. She thought I was older. She thought I was an adult. So she said, you can't go to the studio anymore because you're too young. It's not a safe space. I don't think you should. And I think that was good, a good decision. I have no problem with it. So I went to the studio one last time to say goodbye. I can't come anymore because my sister says I can't come. And so my mentor, my big brother, volunteered to take me home and sit and talk with my sister to ask for permission for me to come to the studio because it's safe because he was there. And he spoke to her. She gave her permission. She said, okay, then she feels better. Because she trusts him. She didn't know him, but she recognized him, which is something I keep telling people. The fact that you recognize somebody from TV, guys, you don't know them. Stop assuming you know any of us because any of us is capable of anything. Just treat us like any random stranger because we are. So when we start going to the studio now, one day this fella move him house, and he was moving, let me give you the geography now, not trying to identify him because we passed this already. I was living in Zadie Gardens. He was moving to Queensberry. I was coming from the studio at Maxfield. Now he was driving and he said he could give me a lift home. And I said, okay, fine. This is after I got permission and I was going to studio now. And this is middle day. So he said, along the way, he said, oh, but I have to make one quick stop at the new place. You mind? Now, if I had known Kingston, remember me fresh from country, now, St. Mary Bush me come from, you know. If I knew the geography of Kingston, I would have known that something was wrong because you don't pass Queensberry to get to Zadie Gardens at the top of Boulevard. However, he went. Me couldn't even identify a landmark, we say. Yeah. But wait, we are past, yes, me no know the road there. So we went to his place and him jump out of the car and him run off and it's like him, I thought, hit him and him turn back and say, so you don't want to see the place? Because this is a new place he's moving into. The place look like some, it's not a townhouse because it look like apartments, but it's multi-level. And then there was a landing in front of his door and some people were there. And I said, okay, cool. Because remember, I'm a mentor, I'm a big brother. Come out and figure look on him place. See him? When I walk in through the door, I pass the people, I'm like, good afternoon, good afternoon. walkie. Remember, me have country manners, you know. Me tell full bus stop of people good morning and nobody no answer me at Kingston. I walk through the door and go in and lock the door with the key. So me I say, that is a little bit odd in my mind because why you lock the door in the middle of the day? But then me say, this is Kingston, all of them are criminal up here. Pure thief. They are Kingston.
Reasoning.
So me let down back my girl and me go down. Walk and show me. You see, when he show me in bedroom, that's it. Me just, he just attack me out. And I'm not expecting. Then the man muscle. Me I try fight off and me I scream because me remember me pass some people out the door.
Right.
So me I ball for help. No, but not even smart in a knock. This is the apathy of Jamaicans. Well, why me and them cuss about rape culture all the while.
Yeah.
And they try to shut me up and I will never shut up because I know us. Me I ball out. Nobody no answer. And then me start get lick. Remember, you know, at that point, I was about 96 pounds. Me lickle, me just knee and elbow. If anybody can remember what I look like when I just started singing, if my friends them know me from school, me tiny. So when me fight and realize that me not get nowhere to fight, and me say, me as well, me stop.
Oh, my God.
Me stop fight and say, all right, me go stop fight. And that was it. Me, at night, me left there.
From middle day?
From early afternoon. Night, me left there. You see, when him finish having me, in care, me go put me in a shower. Scrub me from top to bottom. And then put me in a one of him T-shirt. And when him say, all right, you want to go home now? And me think about the people him out of front. Me shame, and me no want to pass them back. And me say, no. So me never left there till night. For sneak home. And of course, in drop my home. Nobody no question it, me safe. That was it. But me don't want nobody to listen to that. And you hear your daughter or your son say they want to get into music and you use that for judge music. Music
because
did not do
happens.
That.
It happens.
A villain did that. One person did. And if that person was working in insurance, if he was fixing cars, he would have done the same thing because he is that kind of criminal.
Sure, we're going to take a break. Wow. More with you on the other side. Soon come. Funny, you know, I'm here and I'm angry for Tanya, and Tanya says it's okay. I've gotten used to it. I don't know how you do, but that would not even be the last time, because you were sharing this with a confidant of yours, who also took advantage of you, but this time with friends.
Yeah, I had somebody I was dating at 19. So this first incident was 17. At 19. I had somebody I'd known all my life, childhood friend, living at the same community. And I confided in him. I told him about it. It didn't seem like it made a huge impact. He cussed the person and say, yo, I can't believe them man that's here. So he sounded like a sympathizer. We were both young. We're the same age group. Somebody feels safe around him. I know him all my life. I said, this is not a person who would do anything to me. Well, in the summer, when I turned 19, there's always a fisherman's regatta in Port Maria. Parish there. And we went to that regatta together. While I was in Port Maria, I saw my mother. And my mother was headed home. My mother never liked him at all. Just never liked him. My mother couldn't stand the sight of that boy. And I was back then already on my rant against discrimination. Because my mother never think him a full class. And I didn't think anybody was any class. I still don't. But when I saw my mother, she was like, come go yard. May I go home now, come go yard. And I was so annoyed because I'm 19. And you see me with my friend and in front of other people within close proximity can hear and see me and them can recognize me, start singing now. And you say, come go your yard. And that sealed my fate because me rebel. Me never want she order me. So me say no. Normally if she'd have said, I'm going to do X, R, Y, or Z, I might have gone with her. But the fact that she said, come go your yard, me decide say no, definitely not. And I went with him. The other guys are acquaintances from where I go. Me know them. except one person. Mm-hmm. We never know him. But we went up to one of his friend's house. The friend's father was a policeman. Another friend had returned, had migrated, and he'd returned. So them did hang out a bit, and it's like, you know, like a reunion. And I was sitting outside on the veranda, and them inside a chat and thing, and I saw somebody that I know used to run a sound system. Apparently, I think he guessed what was going to happen. And he came, but I don't know him that well, I'm just familiar. So he come to me and say, yo, may I go down at the beach? Come with me. But he didn't say, he didn't give me any compelling reason. I don't know him. Why would I leave this with this random stranger?
Right.
Because so I was like,
with,
no, this is.
And with your friend.
So I went inside to my friends because this creepy dude outside.
Oh my God.
He's trying to get me to leave with him. So I went inside. That was it. Yeah. Yes. I didn't go to the station. So no, this is something that I want people to understand too, because I know that this is not the bulk of what we're talking about. Mm-hmm. But let me just quickly say. People always say, why didn't you say something? Why didn't you do this? Why didn't you do that? Remember, my mother said, come home. I can't go to my mother and say, you were right. I could not. The man whose house I was in is a policeman. I'm not going to the station to report this. There wasn't anybody for me to tell. I'd heard all of my family members who had ever spoken about the topic had spoken about it judgmentally in the direction of the victim. So I'm not going to none of them neither. I already know what I'm going to get. This is what I keep telling people. Your conversations create the environment that makes this flourish. Not just exist, but flourish. We hear you speaking. And this is what informs our follow-up behavior.
And then
only that.
You eventually think you find a safe space in going to therapy and, well...
Oh, Jesus. I go to the most popular therapist because I hear the whole Jamaica celebrate. And go sit down in there. And he asked me some questions. It's the first session, so you know, say, I don't like it, no groundbreaking, nothing happening there. So we kind of just a break ground. We're not really groundbreaking.
Yeah, break, yeah. Okay. That's a writer. Yes.
So I sit down with him. I sat down with him and he asked some questions and stuff. And some of the questions he asked me, I looked at him like, yo, the man, yeah, obey, man. Because he asked me like, so, oh, you want to drinking? And at the time, I've never been an alcoholic. But there have been times when I consume a lot of alcohol. And two different things. Mm-hmm. What we need to learn to distinguish between. But I felt a little bit comfortable talking to him. Because he just feel like, all right, the man know me. And then when we're done, he leaned back in the chair, put his hand over my belly, and said, Tanya Stephens, I must listen back to the music with a different ear. Me feel like he strip off all of my clothes and violate me again. I say, in my mind, I say, run, because the space just suddenly became invaded. My privacy gone, everything when me hide, and my song them and stuff, gone now. So I never went back. I take my therapy on the run, mm-hmm. in other places, and then there are friends outside of Jamaica, of course.
And there are friends on whom?
And there are friends on whom, like, big up yourself, Renee Rattray. Come and ball, but big up me and Matt Lee. Big up Clear. Listen, I have friends though. Well, sometimes me, because I'm antisocial, I think I have no friends. I'm sometimes more say I have no friends, but the truth is I have friends.
Of course you do.
Oh, God, me,
goosebumps, I see them.
I have friends. I have friends. I have so much love.
Yeah, for sure. Well, perfect segue. T, thanks for that. Are some of them in this? Go ahead, Laurie.
Tanya, I know that you don't know what to do with yourself right now, but I'm here for all of it. This discomfort, I love it. I am so honored to celebrate you this evening. I am grateful you're my friend. I'm grateful that we're on this journey together, that we get to be the keepers of hope together, even when it's hard. I thank you for your authenticity. I thank you for always showing up in a bold, true, sincere way, no matter what it is that you believe. You are always going to be your full on self, and so few of us are able to do that. And I'm grateful, I'm thankful that you can say the things that I can't say sometimes. And I want to thank you for being an advocate. You care about children, you care about people, you care about our country, Jamaica, and you are just a great human being who wants to see the best for humanity and for this planet. And I don't know that I know many people like you. And I am grateful that you are here. I am so grateful that you are here. And I can't wait to see what the next leg of this journey has in store for you. I mean, you're the most prolific songwriter ever. And as much as I'm a friend, I told you the other day, you tell me I'm family, but I'm a fan too.
Miss Stevens, you already know I celebrate you and appreciate you. It is an honor to be associated with you. Keep on fighting that good fight. I love you, mommy. By the way, big up Miss Spence for having such a precious gem like you. Bye.
Congratulations on all your success. You see, most people don't know that your success wasn't achieved overnight. It was hard work. Remember what Malcolm Gladwell said in his book, The Outliners? You have to do at least 10,000 hours of work on your craft to be great at it. And heaven knows you have done more than that. It started at St. Mary's High School, then when you were in Outer Rios and toiling, performing at different concerts. And we would talk about the struggles, but yet still you persevere. Now look at you. Look at you reaping all the success of your hard work. My friend, congratulations again.
In the corners of my room, do wait for me. She says she'll leave it. She says she got.
It's a great pleasure to do this video right now because Tanya Stephens is such an important fiber of reggae and dancehall. And our collaboration is still one of the highlights of my career and something that I'm very appreciative of because it happened at a time where not many artists of your stature would have given me that opportunity. So it makes me even more grateful. It says a lot about the person that you are, Tanya. When enough people talk about Tanya Stephens, one of the first things that come up is just how hot Tanya Head is. You know, but what people don't talk about is how thoughtful, how sensitive, and how caring Tanya Stephens is. You know what I mean? And that's why you're one of the few people that I respect, not only professionally, but personally. You know, I'm not just a fan of your music, I'm a fan of you. Enough love, Tanya.
Sometimes you love somebody, but not every time you like them. Yeah, but I always like you, like always, you know? And one of the reasons why we connect so much is because we don't judge each other. I don't judge you, you don't judge me. We laugh, we carry on like two idiots. Me know if you was here, you'd be sitting at the river side right here with me. Me know that's one of your favorite places to be, by the river, you know? And I know you'd be here sitting with me. You're misunderstood out there in the big world because you're always fighting for the underdog. And I yearning that, you know? And we don't always agree on everything, but that too we understand about each other. Not true. Anyway, all the best on your new album. Some Kind of Madness. Because that's who you are. Some Kind of Madness.
First and foremost, may I have to say thank you. Thank you for being the great woman that you are. Thank you for everything that you've done. Thank you for showing me how to navigate the life. Yeah. You know, say it's rough, but every single thing, every step where you take, if you reach where you there, you try to make sure say your path or way for if you can walk to. And me actually love you. You know me love you. You know that. Thank you for making me be the person I'm be today. And thanks for par with me every day. You know, some of my time, well, then I get me a best person for forward because, you know, everybody rate me. But yeah, thank you for par with me every day. Thank you for carrying me go to school. Back in them time, until you start carrying me go to work. And with each journey, you give me more lessons how to navigate this life. Yeah. Thank you so much. You are a great woman, although we cuss enough, but yeah, and I love you.
I only wish I could be there to see your face, because I know you can't do a surprise properly, but since you won't come to Barbados, I'm selling this for you. You see, you when you write lyrics, it's a special gift. And I have maintained that you and David Rudder are perhaps the two most gifted people in the post-independence era when it comes to writing. And whether it is Do You Still Care, or whether it is the Gangsta Blues album or the rest of Revolution, I can say clearly that those lyrics gave me inspiration and fortitude. And I know that they've given so many others the same. But you see me, I don't talk because you haven't come to Barbados, you need to come. And I wish you all the very best in your new album with everything else that's going on. And Tanya, we love you and try and come home down south. Take care.
You wear so many hats in my life. You are a parent, of course. Not be parent, and especially motherhood, not be the fact that I'm a mother. But over the years, you become a friend to me, and now you become a mentor that may become a little bit of a musician. So I think you're absolutely necessary. Say a step out of your shell. You're probably a bomb. Me don't know. Me can't tell the future, or can I? But it's absolutely necessary to celebrate you, because all of we love you, and all of we absolutely appreciate you for having in our life, especially me, because without you, there would be no me. So, love you.
Oh my God. Simone. I don't trust none again.
Why?
I don't know if I'm gonna laugh or cry.
you're doing both. That's part of your mind.
Oh gosh.
Oh. What were you saying about not having any friends?
No? I have friends. I was saying I'm so wrong. Mm-hmm. I apologize to them all the while. Like, it's all. Oh. I can't believe this happened to me on camera. Cut.
She can't laugh, you see? I mean, Sandra was right though.
Oh, wow.
And a couple of other people said it. How misunderstood Tanya is. Like, she is the biggest goofball, sweetheart, laughy, giggly.
Yeah, mess with my badman persona.
Oh, sorry, she's
kill
a tugs.
My barrier
what phrase. I meant to say is that she is a tugs, and we have tugs after this break. Scratch everything else I said before.
Oh,
we'll be right back. And I didn't want you to take them off. All right, so we're putting the lid on this time. Wish we had more time. Oh my goodness. Love, let's talk about Tanya and love. I did not know you were married, and you are now in the process of extricating yourself from that construct. Construct, you call it. Luckily, amicably, because you have somebody with whom. Yeah, but you say love is not on your list of things to do right now.
I mean, I love everybody.
Yeah.
Generally
relationship.
Speaking, but relationship, no. I don't want to do that. Again.
You don't want to do it again?
No.
No, or you don't want to do it again?
I don't want to do it. I reserve the right to change my mind.
Yeah?
But at the moment, it's not something that I'm interested in doing.
Mm-hmm. No. Okay. Talk to me a little bit about your relationship with Kelly. You had her young, you say you wished her something.
Yeah, I was 21.
You and you, but now she's your parish.
I'm a virgin man.
Yeah.
I'm a dog.
Yeah.
Well, we were both new to this. She had never been somebody's child before, and I had never been somebody's parent. So we learned together, and it did rough sometimes. And people, no watch nothing we see on TV, and no much people we see in a public, because we don't fight outside in a public, but we used to fight a lot. And we reach a point now where conversations are mature. Mm-hmm. And we've always been more mature than her age, you know. Because she's always been willing to listen and discuss. And we used to have mother and daughter time where we just sit down and talk. And if she says, Mommy, if me tell her something, I go vex. And I say, no, then me know me cannot be vexed because she's not going to trust me again. So we've always had that. And not only my daughter, but with my nieces and nephews too, we sit down and we talk.
And you were very overprotective of her for a long time. But she never knew why.
She didn't know it. I didn't tell her until she was like late teens. I think what her late teens, me tell her. What happened, and she understood.
Mm-hmm.
But the overprotective is not a good response to the knowledge that bad things happen. You know, you still have to have discussion. It still needs to come down to to having that openness that people can understand. Because look how my mother did talk to me and how me respond. And then me still grew up and never remember that. Because the entire, me can't, me still emotional.
I know.
Me can't believe me can't talk.
What is that?
As well.
Tanya, can I talk? Like, let's just wrap it up right now.
No, sorry.
Like, stop the pressing.
I'm so sorry. Sorry, okay. Sim, but yeah.
It's okay, baby. It's okay.
Azwa, I love you.
Okay. Tell him, Sim. Tell him.
I do. Azwa, I love you for sure. Mm-hmm. You know, me tell him, mm-hmm. I love you.
Yeah,
I love all of my friends. Them. Big up all of me. Can I just pick them up real
quick? Yes.
Renee and you see, the whole of them wicked. Nobody said anything to me. But anyway, love enough.
Right.
I love you so much.
During the affirmation, Tanya said, I hate them so much. Now you've gone to a place of...
No, I love them then.
I don't know.
Yeah, the parenting, Lord Jesus, me got off track.
It's okay. Just tell us where you're at a good place in your life now. You have goals, you say, but you don't set a whole walk of goals.
I don't set a whole heap of goals,
just take your time and set and you achieve and you go again.
And set realistic goals.
Yeah.
I'm not saying you should stay right where you are and just put something immediately in front of you, but... set goals that you can actually see a path to, even if the path rough, but be able to see how you can get there. And then from there, like if you want to get to a 100-mile mark, maybe set the 50-mile mark between those two, so that when you get there, then you can take a little respite and build, and then head for the other 50.
Pause if you must, but don't stop. We say it all the time on the show. Let me tell you, I'm just adding my voice to all the people who love you. Like, I know the other side. I know the, you know, she's great. And Francois loved her too, which is a big
thing. Oh, gosh, we love Francois too.
Okay, now it's time for our affirmation. Thank you, T, so much. So they say circumstances make us what we are, and that is so true, but for better or for worse, where you start does not define where you end up. What tools do you have to navigate your life's journey? Do you know how to use those tools? That's something Tanya asked me. They're useless if you don't. You will need them to be at the ready, because what happens to you along the way can deter you, can derail you, or it can make you even more determined to go after those goals in pursuit of the life you want to lead. It is a pity, but nobody's coming to your rescue. We're all broken people, just trying to be our best selves. And you can keep looking up, expecting it to magically happen, but it takes work and conviction. When you hit those streets, many will take advantage of you, will outright hurt you. They won't love you like you want them to. And that's life, and that's okay. You've just got to love yourself enough to do all you can to push it to the limit, in spite of the noise, the criticism, and the judgment. Just keep at it. Be you. Do you. And one day you will stop and say, boy, I have really come a long, long way. Tonight, we are affirming, roll it up now, I choose to stand for something, lest I fall for everything. That is our show and our soul food for this evening. Thank you guys so much for watching. We will be here next week with another story of the power of the human spirit. Until then, every blessing, and please remember to count your blessings. I'm gonna go and hug up my emotional friend. Kyle look like he needs some emotional support over there. Love you.